Dear friends and colleagues, welcome to this special IFSOS session to pay tribute to one of the giants in the community of IFSOS, a tribute to our honorary president, Professor Nicola Scopinaro. I'm Lillian Cao, president of IFSOS, and together with Luigi Angrisani, chair of the board of trustees of IFSOS, we will be moderating this tribute to Professor Scopinaro. It was a sad day in October when we learned about Professor Scopinaro falling ill, going to hospital, and then passing away. It was the day that IFSOS and all IFSOS members felt a personal loss and mourned the loss of our honorary president. Just to tell you something about Professor Scopinaro, he was known for many achievements. For those of you who have met him, he was many things to the bariatric community. But most of all, he was known as the surgeon who changed the course of bariatric surgery. He was born 6th of March 1945 in Castagneto, Carducci, a small village in the province of Livorno in the Italian region of Tuscany, just southwest of Florence. He went to medical school at the University of Genoa and graduated in 1969. He became the assistant professor in 1971, associate professor in 83, and then the professor of surgery in the same medical school in 1992. He was an acknowledged leader and pioneer of bariatric surgery, but he was probably best known as the originator of the bilio-pancreatic diversion procedure. He conceived this very original operation from laboratory experiments in dogs and applied the principles to human application. This operation, which carries his name, was quickly adopted in many countries. He was an enthusiastic surgeon, a respected innovator, and as an invited speaker, he traveled all over the world. He traveled extensively by car. He used to drive a classic Porsche 11 and also traveled through Italy in his own airplane. He survived two dreadful episodes, one of which he was parachuting, and another few years later when he was driving his car. But he bounced back and was able to lead a normal life. He was also known as a dedicated worker and for his extraordinary vision. As an individual, despite his achievements, many know Professor Scopinaro as a man with a warm heart, a great teacher, a revered mentor, and most of all, the father of modern bariatric surgery. He achieved a lot in his lifetime. As you can see, he performed more than 3,500 bariatric and metabolic surgical operations. He had many publications, over 500, and gave 700 invited lectures globally. For the Italian Society, he was the founder and honorary president. He then founded IFSOS and became the first president and then the honorary president, and also the first president and honorary president of the IFSOS European chapter. He was the first honorary member for many obesity surgical societies, including the United States, France, Japan, Greece, Turkey, Brazil, Spain, Germany, Austria, South Africa, and Egypt. He was the past editor-in-chief of Obesity Surgery, and 2006 was awarded the Outstanding Achievement Award by the American Society of Metabolic and Bariatric Surgery. Something that was not well publicized, in 2007, he was awarded honorary fellowship by the American College of Surgeons. Amongst his accolades, this honorary fellowship was something that Professor Scopinaro deeply cherish. This nomination meant so much to him that he preserved the record of this nomination. Firstly, the envelope of the letter that contained the letter that was sent to him from the president of the American College of Surgeons. And to magnify this, it was to inform him that the Board of Regents of the American College of Surgeons had voted to confer the honorary fellowship of the college to Professor Scopinaro. And of course, he kept this fellowship in its frame and kept in its pristine form. This tweet by Dr. Paolo Grosso on the day that Professor Scopinaro's passing truly sums up what Professor Scopinaro meant to all those he has touched. He said, "If you are lucky enough to know him, if you had the intelligence to understand him, it could only change your life." So Professor Scopinaro, the man who changed the course of bariatric surgery, may his legacy be for all bariatric surgeons, present and future, to remember him and to continue his fighting spirit. In this tribute today, it is my honor to introduce four surgeons who are leaders in bariatric surgery, who have agreed to share their thoughts about the different aspects of Professor Scopinaro's life. We will have Professor Mel Fobey talk about Nicola in the era of open bariatric surgery, Alan Whitgrove in the era between laparotomy and laparoscopy, Henry Buckwell on the origin of metabolic surgery. Francesco Rubina will talk about Nicola in the modern era of metabolic surgery. At the end of that, we're also going to invite Marina Brondo, who has been a longtime friend of Professor Scopinaro, to share her personal and special relationship with our honorary president. I will now invite Professor Luigi Anguissani, another leader in bariatric surgery, past president of IFSO, current chair of the Board of Trustees, to say a few words. Luigi.
Thank you, Lillian. Hello, everybody. And your presentation was really nice. I think summarize a lot of important feature of the life of Nicola life. And the idea of designing the tribute to Nicola with these four leaders involved this morning is just my history with my personal relationship with Nicola. In fact, I met him in a course in a lap band course in bariatric surgery in Umbria in 1995, and that was a special event for Italy, because really for the first time surgeons involved in general laparoscopy and digestive surgery were meeting the greatest personality we had in the field: Nicola Scopinaro and Eddie Mason together. And this was a great opportunity for us. And this started my relationship with Nicola that has lasted basically till the last few days of his life. Next slide. The story, in fact, is that when we met in 1995, as Lilian was saying, he had already lived a full, very, very successful life in the era of open surgery. He was well known all over the world and participated to meeting everywhere, and already was championship of parachuting, was traveling a personal airplane, as you can see in this picture. How can you not be fascinated by men like this? I personally was so admired that my relationship with him became very intense, almost till the last few years. Next slide. And these are a few pictures that Marina gave me of Nicola in his parachuting, in his scuba diving suit. He was going up, down to 40, 50 meters deep in the sea. And this is something I didn't know. He was paragliding overnight. And he was obviously challenging the risk and the adventure anytime. Next slide. But the special challenge that he accepted was when we organized the meeting, the first meeting on laparoscopic obesity surgery in Naples, in Italy, because at that time, I was confident in the possibility of laparoscopy, of entering the field of bariatric and replacing the field of bariatric. And he was a bit skeptical. And this meeting was created by him accepting the challenge. And he told me, you invite all the friends and the people you know that are laparoscopy in the world, and I invite all the stars of open traditional bariatric surgery. And this was the greatest opportunity for me, because I met Mal, Alvarez Cordero, and Garrido, and in between those great personality and great friends that I still continue to see, there was Alan. And Alan made the difference, because he was in between. He was the old fashioned, because he had performed a number of open operations, scopinara operation. He had done biliopancreatic diversion in San Diego. And he was the originator of the laparoscopic technique for Roux-en-Y, so therefore was representing for me exactly where I wanted to go. And together with Nicola, we went to visit Alan afterwards. And this meeting, I think for my life, was really a miliary stones for my relationship with him and with obesity surgery. Next slide. And this was the most fascinating things that over the years, I was organizing a meeting almost every year in Naples, and wherever in Italy he was invited, he was going with his own airplane. And one of the real problem when was the meeting was settled in Capri, when we decided to do the European meeting in Capri. And he wanted, and he said, well, I am coming with my airplane. I said, okay, but in Capri you cannot land because there is no airport. There is, you can come by helicopter. And he was discussing helicopter, and this was, And there was a long time of arrangement for him to land in Naples and taking him from the airport to the island of Capri. But next slides. Capri was special. Was a meeting where We really, together with him, of course, as a honorary president of the chapter and of the meeting, we met the most of those people we had encountered in Naples at the beginning, and basically those people coming in Naples were pioneer of bariatric laparoscopic surgery, and Capri in 2008 was the realization of a dream that basically constantly over the years, by open laparoscopy, the entire world of bariatric surgery switched to the laparoscopic technique. Next slide. This is my final slide, and the way I like to think to you. So I think, sorry, I now invite Mal, because he was really one of his best friends in the open era of bariatric surgery, and I thought he was the best witness of that time. Thank you, Mal, please.
Good day. Thank you, Luigi, and thank you, Lillian, for the nice introduction, and thank you for making me a part of this tribute. It is with a heavy heart that I join all of you today to pay tribute to my friend Nicolas, a colleague and a true scholar who has contributed uniquely to the field of bariatric surgery. I first met Nicolas in 1980 in Iowa at the Bariatric Surgery Colloquium, where he was talking about the biliopancreatic bypass. In the room with about 48 persons at that time, because it was a very small community of doctors who did bariatric surgery, who used to get together and at the invitation of Dr. Mason in Iowa to discuss bariatric surgery. Dr. Nicola was a tall, young, handsome person with an Italian cut suit with a very thick accent, who spoke slowly but deliberately. He was talking about the biliopancreatic bypass, an operation that he had invented as a modification to the jejunoileal bypass. He had just published his initial results in the British Journal of Surgery in 1979, and he was explaining why this was the procedure of choice. The original purpose for the biliopancreatic bypass, as stated by Nicolas, was to obviate the untoward outcome from the anatomical and functional conditions that made the JI bypass not desirable. The JI bypass had indiscriminate malabsorption, had interruption of the intrahepatic bile salt circulation, and presented with a long blind loop, and Scopinaro wanted to avoid these complications. He coined the term alimentary tract, biliopancreatic tract, and the common tract. He diverted the bile through the biliopancreatic tract, and this met distally to form a common tract. Nicolas had done a lot of experimental work on dogs. He started by doing a JI bypass and then subsequently did his biliopancreatic bypass on dogs, studying various lengths. He started with what was called a half and half and a 50 centimeter common limb. Then he did a half and a half with a reduced common limb of 15 to 30 centimeters. And then he did what he called a total biliopancreatic bypass. After looking at the nutritional outcomes, he decided to do what was called a 200 centimeter biliopancreatic limb with a 50 centimeter common limb, and then used a 400cc pouch. His last modification was to reduce the pouch size to 250, as you see on the diagram on the right. The final change was the name of the procedure was changed from biliopancreatic bypass to below pancreatic diversion. This is where Nicholas and I had a discussion at one of the meetings, and I had explained to him that the word bypass had a bad connotation, and that is why I described the bypass as a limiting proximal gastric pouch with a Roux-en-Y gastroenterostomy. Nuclear looked at me and says, "Mal, that makes sense. I think I'm going to call this the below pancreatic diversion rather than the bypass." And that gave birth to that name. From then on, Nicola was present with us at various meetings in Iowa, which subsequently became the American Society for Bariatric Surgery. This was formally launched in 1983 in Iowa with Dr. Mason as the first president. And after that, the meeting was moved from one city to the other, going from Iowa to Minneapolis, to Chicago, Dallas, and other places. The other place where Nicola and I met was in Italy, where he had a yearly meeting, in Genoa, and then to Rapallo, and then Santa Margherita, and then to Rome, and then Naples, and then back to Genoa. It was a very friendly get-together with about 15 to 20 surgeons coming from overseas to join Nicola in Italy. It was a very nice time to get together. We had good Italian food, good Italian music. After that, the other meeting where we met regularly as bariatric surgeons in a small club of people who knew each other, bringing their wives, was in Los Angeles, where I had an annual meeting from 1982 to 1992. Nicola was a regular participant. He was a regularly invited person who presented and talked about the below pancreatic bypass. When he came to the meeting, Dr. Hollian from Santa Barbara, Wesley Clark, and Whitgrove from San Diego, who were also doing the procedure, were present. At this meeting, we also had other people like Dr. Baltazar from Spain and Dr. Carlin from San Diego, and then Dr. Luke Lemons from Belgium. So the procedure you see here, the below pancreatic diversion, became the official procedure that Nicola was advocating to, and which all of you know him of. From the meeting I had, Dr. Cowan took my meeting to Memphis for the sixth annual meeting and called it international meeting, and that gave birth to an international meeting, which took us to Italy, Japan, Australia, Israel, London, and then finally to Sweden. As you can see here, at the time of these meetings, the Ethicon exhibit was this big. It was like 4 feet by 6 feet wide. One of the meetings we went to, which was very interesting, was in Echuca in Australia, where Dr. Nicola, Josh Cowan, and Dr. Naslum and I were the keynote speakers. The thing that was interesting in this meeting is Andrew Jameson and Harry Friedberg was very good host. They took us on a balloon ride. We went and saw how the wool was taken off the sheep. And we went out in the morning for bird watching. The international meetings were also very interesting because there was a lot of exchange. And many of you remember the exchange that Scopinaro had with Sugarman about limiting the pouch and malabsorption, small restriction on malabsorption. And some of you remember the exchange with Dr. Molina, where he told Molina to increase the incision as he was doing the banding procedure and do a more effective procedure. And the final international meeting was in Sweden in 1995, which I could not attend because a patient developed a leak the day before the surgery and I had to cancel my trip. At this international meeting, IFSO was born. Nicola was the first president, and after that lived to be the honorary president. The next and the first meeting of the IFSO was in Prague in 1996. I know I'm talking mostly about his academic contribution, but you all know Nicola. He was a lively person. You can see him there. They were together at my house. Most of the doctors came with their wives. My wife dressed them up in African outfit. We had a nice time. Nicola liked life. He enjoyed smoking, drinking, swimming, and flying. And I had a lot of fun with Nicola. He allowed me to smoke while we're in Cleveland Clinic where we couldn't smoke because we went to the bathroom and smoked under a shower. And we were able to have wine in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. I don't know how he got it there, but he was able to. And many other things we did as fun. We had so much time together. And Nicholas sent his daughter Caroline to spend time with me and my daughters. I have four daughters in Los Angeles in the 80s. The last time I saw Nicola was in Madrid when we got together at the meeting that was hosted by Dr. Torres. And even though he was in a wheelchair at this time, Nicola was still lively, involved in scholarly exchange. I had the privilege of hosting Dr. Nicola lately in India on two occasions at the indoor campus where Dr. Bandera and I work when he came for one of the hand-on courses. And then in the meeting in Delhi when we had the standardization meeting in 2018. Nicola, we'll miss you physically. You will always be with us in spirit. Thank you for the good times we had together. Thank you for your contribution to the field of metabolic surgery. I would like to thank my staff and colleagues at Mohawk Bariatric and Robotic Surgery Center in Indore, a leading bariatric center in Asia Pacific. You are the ones that helped me make this presentation. And again, thank you for making me a part of this.
Thank you, Manuela. You gave me the words again. I feel better now. I think I was very pleased by Mal's presentation that really perfectly targeted the idea that I had that he could design the evolution of the progress of bariatric and metabolic surgery in his slides, because this is exactly what to some I'm getting old, but at that time was young when I met Nicola. I was 35, and the idea, it was not clear to me the enormous impact that he made in transforming the malabsorptive surgery from jejunal ileal bypass in biliopancreatic, and this is why I think I thank you, Mal, too, because I realized this in the last few years, let's say 10 years ago. But when I started, it was not clear to me the enormous impact that he made at that time for bariatric and metabolic surgery. So thank you very much. And we just move now to the extraordinary exciting phase of the born of laparoscopy, of the discovery of laparoscopy in bariatric, of which Alan for me represent the modern father of laparoscopic bariatric and metabolic surgery, and with Alan and Nicola we had incredible time together over the meeting, and especially in San Diego that Nicola loved very much to be very often. So, Alan, please start your presentation.
Thank you. It really is an honor for me to say a few words in tribute to Professor Scopanero. And I'll try to get through this this part of it. This is how I saw myself in relationship to Nicola. He was larger than life. He was professor, researcher, scientist who had published reams of papers and book chapters. And I was just starting out in private practice as I got out of the Navy in 1985. Wes Clark was a surgeon with me in the Navy, and we got out at the same time and set up practice in San Diego. Wes had worked for a time with Darwin Helene in Santa Barbara area. And as Mal had talked about, Darwin had been performing BPDs for quite a while. Kind of interesting going back on some of these slides. Maybe I should take my picture off. Professor Scopanero was a godlike figure, especially to us mortal basic general surgeons. I got the opportunity to meet Nicola for the first time in one of the courses made possible by Malphobia, as he had talked about. And he was everything I thought he would be. He was thoughtful, scientific, professorial, and yes, he was hard to understand at times. By the early 1990s, Wes and I were following more closely in Nicola's footsteps as we began our research and publication phase. We merged with Dick Catlin in 1992, and we were doing bypasses and BPDs. As Dr. Scopanero's diaspora grew, many of us knew Nicola in this fashion, being able to lecture on almost any topic at almost any time. Many of you watching this probably won't understand what these next couple of slides were, but this is the way we used to do surgery. We would do it in an open fashion. We'd measure everything. Wes and I would paralyze the bowel with atropine and then make all of our measurements. And we wanted to make sure that everything was exactly the same every time. In 1993, we did the first laparoscopic gastric bypass, and I remember presenting at ASBS, at that time ASBS, in 1994. And as I waited to present, Nicola came over to me and he told me how proud he was of me. He thought it was an amazing feat. He added very quickly, however, "Of course, I'll never do this, and you're doing the wrong operation, but it's an amazing feat nonetheless." Laparoscopic surgery had started at that time. The instrumentation was a little bit strange, and we had to develop more and more instrumentation as our expertise grew. So the surgical field began to change from open access platform to a laparoscopic platform. I was honored, as Dr. Luigi Agrisani just had mentioned, to have Dr. Scopanero and Dr. Agrisani come to our course in San Diego, and more honored to be invited to Italy in 1999 to Napoli. And of course, the thoughtful and innovative Nicola Scopanero was part of the changes going on in bariatric surgery, as he was to the very end. here in this publication an article on laparoscopic, of course, biliopancreatic diversion as he did the right operation. Over the years, I was blessed with also seeing the side of Nicola that I didn't appreciate early on. As had been mentioned earlier, we were able to spend more time together, and I learned about his zest for life, his non-professorial side. I think every surgeon has one or two or several role models that help shape their life and their careers. And Nicola was one of these individuals for me. He was special. It was capped off in 2009 when he wrote a letter of recommendation for me, sent it to the Dean of Surgery, and that letter was instrumental in my becoming a professor of surgery here in San Diego. So as I remember Nicola, I think of him in a split screen. He was an amazing scientist, author, surgeon, and lecturer, but he had a zest for life that lived as well. I'm proud to have him as my role model, someone who pushed me to do better, as well as my friend. May he be in peace. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Alan. Because this was a very nice reflection on this special part of our life together, the migration, let's say, from open to laparoscopic bariatric surgery, and it's very nice also the way you commented on the fact that he was completely admired by the fact that you had performed and had been able to reach such a complex procedure by laparoscopy, but on the other end, he was commenting that the operation was wrong. This is great. He was typical of his character and his feature. Okay, thank you very much. I'm very happy, and that's, I think Nicola would be very happy of what we are doing. Now Lilian will continue the presentation. Thank you, Lilian.
Thank you. I've really enjoyed Mel's presentation as well as Alan. What a wonderful man as Professor Scopinara was, that part I never saw at that time. I look forward to the next presentation, which is from Henry Buckwell from Minnesota. Henry is a distinguished member of many national and international societies, and he's certainly another pioneer of bariatric surgery. And you're going to tell us about the era with Nicola in the metabolic surgical era. Thank you, Henry. Welcome.
Luigi, thank you so much for the introduction. This is a sad moment for me to give this talk on Nicola and the origin,
of metabolic surgery.
As we all remember
the very great Nicola Scopinara.
Can I have the next slide, please? The picture here is one of my favorite pictures of Nicola in his very active youth that lasted many, many years, in front of a bookshelf, serious, erudite, and very much in control. Next slide, please. In 1978, Richard Varco and I published a book called Metabolic Surgery. Next slide. And in this book, we define metabolic surgery as the operative manipulation of a normal organ or organ system to achieve a biological result for a potential health gain. Now, the most common metabolic operation today is bariatric surgery. We take out pieces of the stomach, we cut vagus nerves, we move the intestine around, and we achieve a metabolic milieu in the body to counteract a bad metabolic milieu that causes obesity and diabetes and so on. People have said we do restrictive surgery, malabsorptive. These are just gross terms, really quite meaningless. What we're doing is influencing metabolism in order to correct metabolism. Next slide, please. Now, my job is to talk about Nicola in the early days of metabolic surgery. Well, in the early 1970s, Nicola came and visited me in Minnesota. He came for two purposes. He wanted to learn and see me scrub and so on in the partial ileal bypass for lowering cholesterol, also a metabolic surgery procedure, and to learn about jejunal ileal bypass, which was started in 1953 in Minnesota by my colleague Richard Varco. And that was the operation in the late 60s, 70s. I must have done close to 1,000 of them. And the operation caused maximum weight loss, was great for weight loss. But in addition to correcting bad metabolism, it also created many metabolic side effects, such as kidney stones, which could lead to renal failure, progression of NASH and cirrhosis of the liver, pustular skin eruptions and these cracks at the angles of the mouth, angular chelitis, and actually loss of cognitive mentation. Nicola and I thought about this a great deal, and we concluded that the cause of this was the overgrowth of bacteria in the bypass segment, which was isoperistaltic, but static. There was no real flow in it. It was not yet a biliopancreatic segment. And this overgrowth of bacteria elaborated toxins and even alcohol that caused the deleterious damage. Next slide. Well, Nicola went home to Genoa, and there gave birth to the biliopancreatic diversion in 1979 was the first major publication. And what was this operation? It was a hemigastrectomy, so different from the current duodenal switch or SADI, which is a sleeve gastrectomy. A gastrojejunostomy to establish continuity with the root limb of jejunum, and the reestablishment of bowel continuity by a jejunal ileostomy, 50 centimeters, mind you, 50 centimeters from the ileocecal valve, and that was the common channel. Next slide, please. Now, Nicola, the surgeon, published this paper in 1979, and let me show you a summary. Next slide. He called this biliopancreatic bypass at the time for obesity, Article 2, initial experience in man. And this is what he wrote, I quote, after a successful trial of biliopancreatic bypass in dogs, so he didn't just rush into human work, he first worked in the laboratory. A clinical study has been completed in 18 patients followed for 1 year. This was a very careful researcher. He didn't rush into the literature. He waited a year. It is suggested that this procedure may be an alternative to jejunal ileal bypass in the management of obesity. Next slide, please. Well, Nicola, the metabolic surgeon, was Nicola, the physiologist. And this is a Cardinal paper that he published in 2012. Next slide. In this paper, he went over all of his laboratory notes, all of his publications, published a paper called 35 Years of Biliopancreatic Diversion, Notes on Gastrointestinal Physiology, to complete the published information useful for a better understanding and clinical use of the operation. He put together his laboratory notes, his publications, all giving physiological explanations based on true data of the metabolic mechanisms created by the biliopancreatic diversion on lean body mass, fat, and viscera, and its influence on caloric consumption, weight loss, and weight stabilization. He wasn't satisfied with an operation that works. He published how it works. Next slide. Nicola, the diabetologist, and next slide is an explanation of this article. Next slide, please. In 2011, he published a paper, which was a follow-up to his 1998 paper. In 1998, he and Walter Pores of the United States concurrently published papers saying that bariatric surgery, in the case of Walter, it was gastric bypass, in the case of Nicola, it was biliopancreatic diversion, resolved or even cured type 2 diabetes. These were the first publications of the effect on diabetes carefully studied. And in 2011, he did a remarkable thing. And he published biliopancreatic diversion improves or resolves diabetes in BMI 25 to 35 without causing excessive weight loss, its action being on insulin sensitivity and beta cell function. Again, the physiologist. But what did he show? That the operation with the greatest weight loss, and people were afraid often of this operation for nutritional problems, actually can resolve diabetes in people with a low BMI, and they didn't fade away. They stopped at a normal weight or a near normal weight. Next slide, please. So that's my scientific summary. A few words about all the years that I knew Nicola. Nicola the daring. Nicola was a man of action. He skied for speed. He was a scuba diver in dangerous waters at great depth. He flew airplanes, often he crashed them. He drove sports cars, often he crashed those. And I don't know how many people know that he took desert car tracks across the Sahara in competition. His main sport was skydiving, and he won 5 consecutive Italian championships. And in 1976, the only Italian medal in a world championship. In 1977, his chutes didn't open until about 100 feet above the ground, and he hit rather hard. He had 13 fractures, internal bleeding. He spent months in the hospital. When he got out, 6 months later, he could barely walk, but he put on his equipment, he went up, and he took a dive right at the spot where he was injured. And in 1978, he came back and won another Italian skydiving championship. I put down wheelchair racer. Why? When he was handicapped later in life, forced to use a wheelchair, he got an electronic wheelchair. And I remember when we were at meetings in large hallways or at a hotel, he would race down that hallway in his wheelchair. Always Nicola the daring. Next slide. Nicola the friend. I knew him for 47 years. We were co-editors of Obesity Surgery from 2009 to 2011. We never had an argument. We agreed on our policies. Next slide. Our last trip together, we took many trips together, was in India. We visited with my youngest daughter, Dana, the Golden Triangle. And here he is with his canes. And he was the daring Nicola there too. He chased some billy goat down a ravine to take its picture. Fell out of his chair, bruised himself, got cut up a little bit, got himself back into his chair, and took the picture of the billy goat. Next slide, please. Whenever we met and when we wrote to each other, he coined a phrase. He would end his letters not with best wishes, regards. He would say, I embrace you tightly, or I embrace you ever so tightly. So when we met in a meeting, he would stop, or I would stop talking to somebody, whatever we were doing, and he would come over, put his arms around me, and say, I embrace you ever so tightly. And at this moment, Nicola, my friend, I embrace you ever so tightly. Rest in peace. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Henry. That was a lovely recollection of all your memories of Nicola. We can see that you were friends for many years and you've cherished almost every moment of it. Thank you for sharing those moments.
Well, Nicola didn't let you do anything but cherish every moment.
Which is great. Well, I think we will move on to the next era of Scopinaro's life, which is the era of metabolic surgery. And I can't think of anyone more suitable than Francesco Rubino, who many of you know was the reluctant bariatric surgeon who saw the light and is now become a pioneer in metabolic surgery and hails from King College in London. Francesco, welcome.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Lilian, Luigi, Manuela, and thank you, IFSO, for really giving me this great honor to participate in this tribute to Nicola Scopinaro. Nicola was not just a master of surgery to me, but was also a friend. We had a great relationship, and as in every great relationships, we had our ups and downs. For some years, Nicola and I took different paths, but here in 2019, I was proud to be taking this photograph with Nicola as a sign that our friendship and our respect, mutual respect, never went away, even in the more difficult times. So I have the pleasure to remember Nicola and everything he has done for our field, but also for my professional life. And I'll, in this short presentation, I'll try to balance both contributions. Nicola was an Italian man and an Italian surgeon. And as a fellow Italian, I definitely recognize the characteristic flaws of Italians, but also the merit that some of my fellow Italians have. And Nicola impersonated all of them. Much has been said about his life, about his passion for cars, for difficult, for dangerous sports, for life in general. But I think when it came to medicine, Nicola had this idea of medicine that I think a lot of us in Italy have when we start medical school. We think medicine is for the benefit of humankind. And I think Nicola had this ambition always at all time to do something that would change the world. And indeed it did change the world of bariatric surgery and the world of many patients around. He also impersonated those that typically Italian, characteristically Italian characteristic of thinking that the world is your playground. He goes around, he went around, and he thought that every time he thought about medicine, it was for the resolution of problems of men and women around the world, not necessarily always limiting to what medicine could be, restriction of medicine in different countries, big different systems in different places. Nicola looked at the big picture all the time. But I'm being asked to say what Nicola did for metabolic surgery, for modern metabolic surgery. And I think Nicola did a lot of things for modern metabolic surgery. Even if he did some of these things many years ago, they are still incredibly valuable today. And I can bet they will be valuable in the future. For one, of course, as it has been said before, Nicola developed, invented this new procedure that brings his name, Scopinaro's procedure. That how I met Nicola the first time, from books and textbooks and from publications. He was the name behind an operation, but it was much more than his operation. Nicola was a metabolic surgeon in the very spirit of this term, because Nicola didn't look at surgery only as a way of technically reproducing an operation and make it work, etc. But Nicola looked at how things work. Why should we do this? And he made, as is it's been said before, a lot of research about the physiology behind the operations. And he always said, if you don't understand the physiology of an operation, you should not be doing it. That was one of the many lessons I learned from Nicola. He you know, characteristically was saying that you cannot combine restriction and malabsorption, because where only one mechanism is active, and in case of his procedure, he thought that malabsorption would be the dominant mechanism, you only get the negative effect of the second one. I think this is a lesson that stands today for so many young metabolic and bariatric surgeons, and I think there are many more that he gave just by more broadly inspiring us to think more about what we do, not to just use scalpels, but to use our brain, our thinking, to make our operations better and our care better. But I want to say something more personal here. So it has been said that if you know, somebody's action inspire others to dream more, to learn more, to become more, then those people are leaders. And so I do think Nicola is clearly a leader, was clearly a leader, but it was a leader to me in particular. And the reason is because he did inspire me. He inspired my change in my career. I was not by any means thinking to become a bariatric surgeon. And if I did, in fact, I was a reluctant bariatric surgeon. If I did, it is to a great extent to what Nicola has done in Britain. My very eureka moment, my personal eureka moment, was still believe it, remember it, on July 3rd, 1999. Nicola, I hadn't met Nicola yet, but my mentor at the time, Dr. Gagné, performed the first laparoscopic biliopancreatic diversion. Just a few days later, a few weeks later, Nicola flew to New York. I was a fellow with Dr. Gagné, and was sent to JFK, where I met him with Marina and Giuseppe Marinari, and to me, he was the big professor on that day. But I was so eager to meet him because I wanted to tell him that on this day, on July 3rd, 1999, without him knowing it, he did change my life. And the reason that happened is because I was browsing in the library of Mount Sinai articles about biliopancreatic diversion to understand how we could make it simpler so that it could become easier to perform laparoscopically. I wanted to impress my mentor, Dr. Gagné, that he could do it quicker if we found a way to cut some aspects of it and make it technically different. But what really struck me, I couldn't find really an answer to that question, but what really struck me was this table in his 1998 paper on World Journal of Surgery. Now look at this. In this paper that I was just browsing with no attention, paying attention to completely different thing, I noticed that he reported remission, disappearance of diabetes in basically 100% of all the patients who had either diabetes or pre-diabetes or diabetes on insulin. It was that observation that as I browsed the other page made me go back and say, wait a minute, this is something odd. That very moment changed my entire career, changed my interest for this field. So I shared with Nicola the idea that maybe we could use surgery to treat diabetes. And he became an enthusiast, so much enthusiast that ever since we became best friends. And we shared a lot of nice memories, but Nicola had this passion for metabolic surgery, that he would travel to any meeting where we were discussing the new idea or the new data or something that could become something more important. And he came to Strasbourg, I remember I was at the time in Strasbourg, France, even days after having a major operation for a perforated stomach. He had an open surgery and he flew to Strasbourg because he said, this is too important to me, I want to be there. That was also Nicola in so many ways. Nicola was also part of the first, I think this is really the very first meeting for surgical treatment of diabetes ever organized. This was in Strasbourg on June the 1st, 2006, where we discussed the very idea of diabetes surgery as a new surgical specialty. And Nicola came to present about long-term control of diabetes after bariatric surgery with a data about long-term data from BPD, the Scopinaro procedure. And I can tell you, I can anticipate that his procedure still today works so well for diabetes. We're about to publish in The Lancet next month the 10 years results of the randomized trial that with Dr. Migroni and other colleagues we performed. And now we have 10 years data. And there is definitely a legacy for that operation in diabetes surgeries, as there is for Nicola himself. Nicola was also part of the very initial group of people who helped us organize the Diabetes Surgery Summit. He was part of the International Organizing Committee, and Nicola was a really enthusiastic participant in that very initial event where we made the very first recommendations. A few months later, just to tell you what Nicola thought about metabolic surgery, he sent an email to me where he said the entire scientific community should be grateful for this huge and very important effort, which will constitute an everlasting landmark in the field of metabolic surgery. This is one of the many things I save personally as a memory of Nicola and his words, the words of the great Professor Scopinaro, for, of course, as was something of very important for all the other colleagues involved in the Diabetes Surgery Summit, including myself, because he was part of that initiative as well. For reasons unknown to me, somebody must have convinced Nicola a few years later that the new era of metabolic surgery, diabetes surgery, this whole thing was probably not recognizing the merits of his operation, and perhaps that misleading advice he got from somebody has led, regrettably, to him and I becoming less friends for a little bit of time, for a few years. I regret that has deprived me of this great friendship, of some years of great friendship, but I was so proud to get back together with Nicola a few years later, become friends as we have always been before. And I say one of the best emails I ever received, where he came back after DSS-2 to say to me that he thought diabetes surgery was indeed something new, something that he felt he could have contributed more. And I told Nicola that he contributed a lot to it, much more than he perhaps believes. And we, I really think Nicola in that email showed mending all the differences we had and coming back together, that he was an intelligent man, because intelligence is the ability to adapt to change. And Nicola adapted to change eventually, and he embraced metabolic surgery, even though it wasn't initially happy for some of the things he was seeing happening. But then he eventually said, this is exactly what I think we should do. This is the way for the future. And that makes a great leader, that makes a great man, that makes really a giant, the ability to change, the ability to go beyond yourself. I want to say that one of the way Nicola contributed to metabolic surgery is by giving us an example. As I said, he was the first to talk about mechanisms, to make sure that mechanisms are important as we choose operations, as we decide who to operate. And he knew mechanism more than anybody else before we started to make metabolic surgery indeed the discipline of mechanism of action. And in so many ways, he invented an operation. He gives inspiration with his own life, his own professional career, somebody who never missed an event, never missed an IFSO meeting, even any meeting, even if he was sick, even if he had an operation 5 days before, even if he was coming on wheelchair. He gives us so much inspiration that if we really now, all of us, can work in the field of metabolic surgery, and we see a field that has matured, that has become centerpiece in diabetes and many other for many other diseases, it is thanks to people like Nicola. And so this is a very often used sentence, and that many use sometimes not appropriately. I think it does apply to Nicola, because if we all can work in this field today, it's because of giants that had the ability, but even more the courage, to start and work in a field many years before us, when it was much more difficult than it is today because of the prejudice against obesity and bariatric surgery. Somebody said, and this is my conclusion, that there are two ways like light can spread, either through a candle or by being reflected by a mirror. There is no question in my mind that Nicola was a candle. He was a candle. He had his own light, and he has spread this light for me, for many of my colleagues, contemporaries, and I'm sure and confident it will be a light that will inspire many other generations of surgeons in the field of modern metabolic surgery. Grazie, Nicola.
Well said, Francesco. I think you've summed up what the extraordinary vision that Nicola had to everyone and to bariatric surgery and metabolic surgery. And also he set what a wonderful example to our present and future bariatric surgeons. Thank you for sharing that with us. Well, we're going to come to another personal contribution. Marina Brondo, a very special friend and longtime friend of Professor Scopinara. Thank you for coming, Marina, for sharing your special relationship that we probably don't know and would love to hear your version.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you all for what you have organized today for Nicola. Thanks especially to you, Manuela. I consider you, as you often told me, a special person, a special friend. I met Nicola many years ago, 27 to be precise. I was a student. He was my general surgery professor. What can I say? He was an incredible person. He was handsome, and it was impossible for anyone lucky enough to meet him not to be totally fascinated by him, by his charisma, by his immense culture. In a short time, Nicola became my life teacher, my mentor. In the following years, he became my sail, my support, my home, my soulmate. There has not been a single day in all these years that Nicola has not been present in my life, and I in his, until the end. I have never met a more honest, generous, and upright soul than him. He was always available to help anyone in need, anyone who asked him. He was alive. House, a life for all of us. His death leaves in me an excruciating pain and a void that will never be filled. His death leaves you an immense moral and academic legacy. You will carry out his thoughts, his words, his studies. You will do it, because for him, all of you were like a family, his companions for all his life. To you, Nicola. To you, Luigi. To you in particular, Nicola lives his ideological witness. To you, who has always considered as a son and who have always been by his side. I know that his memory will never die. His teachings and values will remain forever. Always carry them with you, together with the thoughts of his mind. I will do it every day of my future without him by my side. Thank you all.
Marina, it is a complicated moment, I must say. I have a terrible attitude that is that during my normal life, I think I have been thinking what is going to happen when this person died, when that was applying to my grandfather, to my father, to my relatives, and I was imagining what happened after somebody that is close to you is going to die. But I must confess to you that I never thought that Nicola could die. I've never been thinking, although he has been so bad in his life for a number of situations, had a number of operation. I remind when he had the spine surgery, and you, Marina, must remember that time, that was at some stage, I couldn't have his news for, and I think Harry Buckwald, we called each other for some time to find out what was happening, and at some stage nobody was giving any answer, and I called to his team, to Gianfranco Adami and Beppe Marinari, say, but what is going to happen to him, where he is, because he was at some stage the news was that he was in ITU and no news. And one of the things that was told me from the other side, from his team, said, yes, we know that he's not well, but we are not worried at all, because he will certainly survive and come back, because he was so determined in his life. As Francesco was mentioning, it is difficult to think that something could stop him from doing things he wanted to do. So he's an amazing personality, and Marina, I think, was so nice to have been with him so closely, and especially in this delicate frame that is the last days of his life. So I think it is a special situation that we are living, and I'm very confident that his personality and his spirit is going to be with us, although he will not physically be here. So I think I'm sure of this, and we all, of course, we are all very, very close to you, Marina, for your sufferings. And your ability and your sweetness to have been with him in this situation. Thank you, Marina.
Let me extend condolence from my wife She wanted to say something, but I told her I'll let you know. The other thing I would say while we're sitting here is we talk about ourselves, but one thing that I appreciated about Nicola was his relationship with his patients. I was amazed when I came to Genoa. He seemed to know every patient he had operated on. I mean, I was really intrigued. That's why for a while I thought if you were going to do the scope and narrow procedure, you need to know the patients. And he knew the patients. And he could tell you who was having what complication and what he would have to do for them. And for the young surgeons who are listening, what you can take from Nicola's life is that he cared about his patients. He individualized his care. As a matter of fact, in Genoa, they'll tell you the gastric bypass was still the most common operation, even though the BPD is what Nicola advocated. Because he told me, don't do this operation on every patient. The patient needs special care and support. And that's what a true surgeon would do. You don't do the same operation on everybody. You individualize the care of the patient. You know the science and physiology of the patient. So I just wanted that on this occasion that we talk about my friend, I want that the young surgeons should get something out of it. Because there are many people who just embrace one operation and they do a sleeve on everybody or MGB on everybody. And then they blame the operation. There's nothing wrong with any of our operations. What is wrong is us. And we should learn from Nicola and tailor our operations to the patients. Again, Luigi and the staff, thank you for making me part of this. And Marina, nice to see you again. I'll leave it to the other members on this panel if they have any other things to say.
I have a very short story that epitomizes Nicola's discernment of truth and what is real. We were having dinner together, and he ordered, of course, a bottle of wine. And he ordered a Rothschild at $120. I'd never done that in my life. And the bottle arrived. The waiter made a big ceremony. He took out the cork. He gave it to Nicola. Nicola smelled it. He took a sip and he said, this is not the wine. Send it back. And first of all, I've never ordered a $120 bottle of wine. I've never sent back a bottle of wine. And he sent it back. And they must have switched it or something. And out came a real Rothschild. And Nicola says, yes, this we can drink.
That's right. That's Nicola. Yeah.
Well, that's a wonderful story. Well, today we've heard so many wonderful words about Nicola, so many memories of a wonderful life. Well, I'd like to thank everyone for sharing your stories and your memories. And I'm sure the members of IFSO who have listened in have also enjoyed this tribute. So thank you, Luigi, for initiating this tribute. Thank you to Mel, Ellen, Henry, and Francesco for sharing the different chapters of Nicola's life. And to you, Marina, thank you for sharing his personal life. IFSO members have also memories of Nicola, and many of them have also shared their memories, photos, words, and videos, and they've submitted it to us. And so what's going to follow from here is a collage from all the members of IFSO who have submitted their memories of Nicola. So I'd like to thank Manuela Mazzarella, of course, our IFSO Chief Operating Officer, and Stephanie Diaco, our membership and communication manager, for organizing this tribute and for putting this collage together. For those of you who have not been able to follow this tribute is of course recorded and it will be on our IFSO website from tomorrow. So thank you everyone, and please enjoy the collage that's about to follow. Thank you again. Emmy Nicola, rest in peace.
If so, founded in 1995, is the largest worldwide bariatric and metabolic surgery organization, involving around 70 countries and more than 80,000 members.
I am sailing home again, across the sea. I am sailing stormy waters to be near you,
to be near,
to be free. I am flying.
And now end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, I traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was dark, my fill, my share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way. Oh no, oh no, not me. I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not.
Hello, this is Matt Hutter, the President of the American Society for Metabolic and Bariatric Surgery. On behalf of the ASMBS, I would like to provide this heartfelt tribute to Professor Scopinaro. Dr. Scopinaro was a true visionary who built this field of metabolic and bariatric surgery from the ground up to the heights currently achieved. His insight and foresight, persistence, dedication, and hard work have shaped the field of metabolic and bariatric surgery, not only in his home country, but across the world. With Professor Scopinaro's passing, we have lost a giant in the field. Yet we must celebrate his life and aspire to stand on the shoulders of such a giant, to strive even further and to create even better treatments for our patients for the future. Thank you, Professor Scopinaro, for all you have done to advance the art and science of the surgical treatment of obesity and to bring the world closer together. You will be greatly missed.
Dear Nicola, I would like to thank you today, wherever you may be, for a decades long-standing, loyal, very personal, and close friendship, which we developed in the very first moment we met together in the early 90s. It was indeed a loyal friendship where we went through difficult times shoulder to shoulder and enjoyed both, to overcome the difficulties and to enjoy life. So thank you very much once again, and I embrace you.
I am Professor John Melissas, IFSO President 2006-2007. For the first time, I met Professor Nicola Scopinaro in Prague in 1996. And since then, a real friendship was developed between us. For the many moments that we had together discussing about obesity and bariatric surgery, it's one very special day that I have always in my mind. It was March 1999, and Nicola invited me to visit his department in Genova. I went to Genova and I saw his department and Nicola operating. But most importantly, that night I was invited to his place, to his house. Plan was originally to have a drink and then go out to an Italian restaurant. But the plan was changed completely because we initiated a discussion about what else, obesity and bariatric surgery. I was asking questions, Nicola was replying, solving all my problems, all my queries. I was so excited that I asked him to cancel the restaurant and stay at home and carry on the discussion. I was asking questions, Nicola was explaining everything about pathophysiology of obesity to me and the mechanism for surgical intervention. At the end of the discussion, I was ready to change completely my approach to this chronic disease, and I knew why the worldwide bariatric community was considered Nicola Scopinaro not only as a great surgeon, but also as a fine researcher, scientist, leader, and teacher. Thank you very much, Nicola. I will never forget you. Rest in peace.
Nicola, I'm very thankful for your support, for your mentorship. So I would like to share some thoughts with our friends about moments that we will never forget. We will never forget your sharp brain, your scientific lectures, your excellent moderation. But we had also a lot of fun. For instance, with your birthday cake, biliopancreatic diversion, or interaction with our international friends. In addition, you loved to take pictures. Of course, not only that, you could be very, very funny. And we had a lot of fun. And that is how we want to memorize. This is how we want to keep you in our mind, in our memory. We will never forget your charisma, your legend, and this will always stay in our mind and in our memory.
Good afternoon, my dear friends. Let me share with you some memories I have about Professor Nicola Scopinaro, starting the first time I met him here in Madrid when I invited him to share with us in the University Complutense of Madrid the summer courses in El Escorial. We were sharing experiences, having dinner, a very long dinner from 8 p.m. to 5 a.m. in the morning, having some wine and smoking some cigarettes and sharing, you know, our thoughts about BPD diversion. He emphasized you know, the way of measuring the vowel, both in the animal experimental and in the clinical situation, in the clinical scenario. Then, when we start our SADIS procedure, we were commenting that SADIS, at the end of the day, with this long biliopancreatic limb, was a modified BPD approach to our patient. And then, along all this year, we have been sharing experiences in IPSO and in so many meetings and congresses. We always, and especially me, I will miss you a lot, my dear professor. So, Professor Nicola Scopinaro, dear Nicola, rest in peace forever.
Dear colleagues and friends, Remember Nicola Scopinaro, we have a great loss to complain about. The German society will honor him and never forget. Goodbye, Nicola.
My name is Francesco Papadia, and Professor Nicola Scopinaro has been my boss, my mentor, and the inspiration for what I wanted to be for more than 20 years. Everyone knows him as a legend in bariatric surgery, but I would like to show you the man behind the surgeon, a man capable of showing affection. The year was 2004, and we were attending the annual ASBS meeting in San Diego. I was a resident back then, and I had a presentation accepted. Professor Scopinaro, who was already a legend in the business, took his time to take pictures at me, a humble resident, presenting the paper. Not only that, my presentation happened to be selected for the Best Resident Trainee Award that year. He knew it, but kept the secret until the end, only to take a picture at my surprised face. That was Professor Scopinaro, a great scientist and surgeon, and an even greater, generous and compassionate man.
As Harry Freidenberg, I just wanted to take the opportunity for this memorial meeting to talk a little bit about Nicola, who I first met back in the 80s. In actual fact, I visited him, and there he was operating when the patient was purely vertical and the anaesthetist was in the coffee lounge having a coffee. And Nicola had the stomach out here, and he was doing it manually as an open procedure, as he did so beautifully. And then we went for dinner, and one of the funny things he said to me, he said, "Well, how much do you charge in Australia for these bariatric operations?" And I mentioned a couple of $100 or a few $100 at the time. And I asked Nicola, "How much do you charge?" And he said, more. So there was a funny side to Nicola. Anyway, we certainly all miss him, and may I wish everybody long life. Thank you.
Times are strange, here I come, but I ain't the same. Mama, I'm coming home. Time come by, it seems to be, you could have been a better friend to me. Mama, I'm coming home. You took me in and you drove me out, yeah. Lost and found and turned around by the fire in your eyes. You made me cry, you told me lies, but I can't stand to say goodbye. Mama, I'm coming home. I could be right, I could be wrong. It hurts so bad, it's been so long.